Michigan contributed 90,000 soldiers to the American Civil War. We also contributed horses, timber, agriculture, and copper. Yet some think Michigan's greatest contribution to the war was the boy general with the flowing locks. He was bigger than life. And while he was best known for his defeat by the Lakota and Cheyenne warriors at the Battle of the Little Bighorn, it was during the Civil War that he became one of the most recognized and celebrated cavalrymen in U.S. history. He was always at the right place at the right time with the right action. Now, legend has it that he once heard a superior wonder aloud about the depth of a river the troops had to cross. He immediately rode his horse out to the middle of the river and shouted back, "This is how deep it is." At 23 years old, the colorful, controversial man from Monroe, Michigan, became forever known as General George Armstrong Custer.
From Falling Waters to Brandy Station, Trevilian Station, most of the encounters up through the Shenandoah Valley. I had 11 horses shot from under me during the war, led 60 successful cavalry encounters, and we were in the forefront. The Michigan Cavalry Brigade captured more battle flags, more Confederate prisoners, more cannon than the other unit, and they called us the Wolverines. Eventually, my men took to be calling those Red Tie Boys, those fighting Blue Devils that served under the Boy General with the Golden Locks. I would have had a late start getting into the war because of our five-year curriculum at West Point. We graduated actually a year ahead of time, and I was assigned to Company G, 2nd U.S. Cavalry, and progressively advanced in rank. It was only by being at the right place at the right time. Became a captain on General McClellan's staff in May of 62, and then served under General Alfred Pleasanton, and was promoted with Elon Farnsworth and Wesley Merritt in June of 63 to the rank of Brigadier General. I was but 23 at the time, and was given command of the Michigan Cavalry Brigade. They were all men from the same state. The 1st, 5th, 6th, and 7th volunteer regiments. It was unprecedented that men would all serve in one entire unit from the same state. Being 23 years old, there were men who were my seniors and officers that I jumped over progressively in rank, but that was because they wanted young blood in the service. At the time, the cavalry was scoffed at. There was a saying, "Whoever saw a dead cavalryman?" And we needed to show the Confederates that the South didn't have the advanced cavalry units. The fact that the Michigan Cavalry Brigade turned the tide of battle at Gettysburg. Gettysburg was a chance encounter. To my guesstimate, General Lee was trying to push the war to the north, and the fact that Gettysburg was noted as a shoe manufacturing center, they were in badly need of supplies. The Michigan Cavalry Brigade was assigned to cover the approaches east of town, and Little Round Top was a vulnerable position, and so we were to reinforce infantry troops on Little Round Top. On July 3rd, it was early morning, about 10 o'clock, when I received word from General McMurdy Gregg that there was some Confederate forces forming up on Crest Ridge, a little farm known as Rummel Farm, just east of Gettysburg. Saw what they were fear was possibly General Stuart and General Wade Hampton's Confederate cavalry forming up to hit the right flank of the Union forces atop Cemetery Ridge. If they had effectively been able to maneuver around and cause a disintegration of the right flank, then possibly at the same moment that Pickett was making a successful charge across that open field, the Union forces on Cemetery Ridge would have pulled from the center to reinforce the right flank and made Pickett's charge more successful. As it was, he only received large casualties and quite a bit of cannon fire from the Union forces up there, compelling him to withdraw. If we had not been able to hold that line with General McMurdy Gregg's forces, then quite possibly Stuart would have had the day, and we would have seen a different victory there at Gettysburg. as it was on the 4th. Robert E. Lee was limping woundedly back to Virginia, and there were over 50,000 casualties left lying on that field of battle, three of the most bloodiest days of the war.
His name was actually in the newspapers as having been killed, and that was how I learned of it. But that was not true, that somebody had misrepresented the truth. During the early years of the war, I actually was finishing my schooling, which was very important to me, but I also, being a young girl, was doing very simple things and some things that were really not very much aware of what was going on in the bigger sense of the war. My mother and I in this house would bake fruited cakes for the soldiers, and we'd also do some knitting of socks, which was helpful. But truthfully, my life was more social. My focus was not what my father had intended. He would run every day to the depot and get the most recent newspaper so that he could find out what was going on in the war. It was important to him. He had been a frontiersman and coming to Michigan, and that feeling stayed with him that he had a role to play as well. So even though I was brought up in the environment that I was extremely patriotic and proud to be born here in Monroe, Michigan, I can't tell you that I had the proper respect for what was going on in the world. It was not something that occurred to me. But of course, as you know, my life took quite a turn. Thanksgiving of 62 actually found me being introduced to Captain Custer. So from there on in, a whirlwind courtship occurred, sometimes with the blessing of my father, but early on, no. And then later on, of course, I traveled with my husband with the Army and resided then in Washington in a boarding house. So at that point in time, I was there to support not only my husband, but the Michigan Cavalry Brigade. Unfortunately, we saw many injured or wounded soldiers brought back to the city, and I would go ahead and represent my husband by visiting at their bedside.